Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We've received apologies from the convener. I will therefore be chairing the meeting in his place. We are joined today by Keith Brown, who is attending the meeting as the substitute member in the convener's absence. The first item on our agenda is our final evidence session on our inquiry into effective Scottish Government decision making. And today we will hear from Seán Robison, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, John Paul Marks, Permanent Secretary, who are joined by Scottish Government officials Leslie Fraser, Director of General Corporate, and Dominic Munro, Director for Strategy. So welcome you all to the meeting today. I look forward to your evidence, and I would invite Ms Robison to make a short opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's a pleasure to be here today to talk about effective decision making. I'm conscious that this is a very broad subject area. The Scottish Government takes many decisions of different types on a daily basis. Consequently, I will focus my opening remarks on the areas that I think may be most helpful. The types of government decision-making range from decisions on public investment to decisions on taxation, on service delivery, and, of course, on legislation. In recent times, key decisions have been made on both urgent issues, such as receiving refugees from Ukraine or responding to the pandemic, and on long-term programmes, such as the rollout of social security in Scotland. As these examples illustrate, government decisions cover complex issues, often of national importance and often with a degree of political contention. Understandably, there is no one-size-fits-all approach to such varied decisions, but there are principles and governance that support effective decision-making. In terms of principles, the policy prospectus published at the end of April sets out both the three defining missions of this government, equality, opportunity and community, and the outcomes that we want to deliver over the next 3 years. And as a government, we have developed a distinctive Scottish approach to delivering policy and public services based on four priorities. Firstly, a shift towards prevention. Secondly, improving performance. Third, working in partnership. And fourthly, engaging and developing our people. In terms of governance, the Scottish Cabinet sits on the top level of decision making, supported by Cabinet subcommittees on certain key areas such as legislation. And supporting this, there is a range of official governance under the corporate board and executive team. This is reinforced by official guidance, including the Scottish Public Finance Manual and the Civil Service Code. We recognise the importance of external advice, challenge and scrutiny, including, of course, by this Parliament. We integrate external views into our decision-making in various ways, including through consultations and stakeholder engagement, and through groups such as the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls and the Delivery Board for the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. We also recognise the importance of transparency, which is why we are delivering Scotland's third Open Government National Action Plan in partnership with civil society. It's why we'll set out our financial fiscal assumptions in our medium-term financial strategy later this month, and it's why we routinely publish impact assessments relating to policy decisions. The quality of advice supporting decision-making depends upon the skills, the capability and the professionalism of civil servants. The Scottish Government is implementing its people strategy to support the continuous improvement and updating of skills and capability, and has introduced measures to improve record-keeping as part of its information governance programme. Effective decision-making often requires evidence on what works, and the Scottish Government is supported in this by professional analysts, scientists and other specialists within the civil service, and by expert advisory groups, such as the COVID advisory group that played a significant role during the pandemic. In conclusion, Convener, given the varied nature and complexity of decision-making, as a government, we do not claim to always get everything right, but our decisions are supported by professional advice and formal processes, and we've made many decisions that we can be proud of over the years, decisions that have made Scotland a better place and improved outcomes for people living here. But we're always willing to learn lessons and to improve, which is why the work of this committee is so important, and we look forward to considering its recommendations.
Thank you. I'll start question with Michelle Thompson, please.
Oh, right. I was expecting the tradition to operate at the communal going first. Okay, I think we'll just go in with the heavy brogues then. I have a question that may well be for yourself, Cabinet Secretary. First, I was interested in exploring, do any third sector groups obtain more than 50% of their funding from the Scottish Government?
Well, third sector groups are varied in that
I should say quangos as well. I've not been clear. Quangos,
right,
or third sector groups.
Okay, well, let's take third sector groups first of all. We tend to give the funding through what we call intermediaries, who would then give the funding to third sector organisations, some of which are quite small, that will apply to those intermediaries. And that helps the Scottish Government, as you can imagine, the plethora of small third sector organisations. It makes more sense to do it in that way. Now, I don't have the breakdown of who gets what in terms of percentages in front of me, but I'm certainly happy to furnish the committee with that information. We would encourage third sector organisations to not become wholly reliant on any single source of funding, because for sustainability reasons, clearly the more there's a spread of funding sources, the more sustainable that organisation becomes. Because with the best will in the world, and you'll understand this, sometimes policy priorities can change within government, and that means difficult decisions have to be taken, which can include the ceasing of funding. And so if an organisation is wholly dependent, that becomes difficult. In terms of quangos, in terms of public, we have 129 public bodies in Scotland, and many of those will be reliant on Scottish Government funding. Most of them, in fact, will be reliant on Scottish Government funding. Some are able to raise commercial funding. So if you look at, for example, the forestry and land sector, they have been quite successful in generating commercial money, which is good. And I would just, I guess, make this final point that we are reviewing and want to reform the landscape around the 129 bodies.
Okay.
And that is a piece of work that I'm happy to furnish again the committee as we take that forward with.
Okay, thank you for that. I suppose the general question is, and in fairness, I don't expect you to be able to answer that today, but is there a possibility that some of these types of bodies who receive Scottish Government funding get more than 50% of their income stream? That's a general question. And in fairness to you, I don't expect you to know that data for every single organisation.
There will be some. There will be some.
Okay.
Yes.
So I suppose my next question then is, where would that be declared by the Scottish Government and or the civil service, and you may want to come in here, Permanent Secretary, as a risk in terms of your decision making? Now, I fully accept it's a risk for the organisation themselves because of exactly what you highlight, but it also represents a risk both to the civil servant and to the Scottish Government if there are a number of bodies that are receiving more of their fund, more than 50% of their funding. So perhaps you'd like to come in, Permanent Secretary, and say where would that be? Where in the institutional memory, if you like, is that declared and understood and assessed?
So first of all, for each of the budget lines or grants, it is understood by the sponsor body, the sponsor team that sit within the Scottish Government, and then it is declared in the annual report and accounts. So it may be that there are certain levels of grants that are not above the threshold that are visible through that process. We can take that away and, as the Deputy First Minister says, furnish the committee with a bit more detail. But if I take something like Social Security Scotland, you know, it is a major organisation funded by the Scottish Government to deliver Social Security, and that funding line is visible in our annual report and accounts. So to an extent, we understand that liability, we plan for it, and we make sure that it is funded at a level to deliver the service that we wish. I think, as the Deputy First Minister set out, in terms of public bodies more generally, voluntary sector, where we can encourage revenue raising and that opportunity to create revenue, that can be positive. And when we've seen that in different sectors, we want to encourage that empowerment.
That point, but I suppose what I'm trying to get here is you quite correctly say you'll understand it from a funding line where it represents a liability. What I'm trying to explore is where it represents a risk to quality decision making, mm-hmm. and how you examine and assess that risk on an upfront basis, and therefore critically how you guard against policy capture.
So I mean, I see where you're getting to here. So I mean, first of all, clearly we need to guard against that mm-hmm. any organisation we fund is an organisation we fund to carry out particular tasks. So they would have applied for funding on the basis of meeting the Scottish Government objectives as set out. Where the Scottish Government is taking policy decisions and consulting, I wouldn't expect organisations that respond to that consultation, and we would be looking at what they're saying in the round alongside all the other organisations, whether we fund them or not. So my expectation would be there's no hierarchy of, you know, importance of their views on a subject that in any way correlates to whether or not they're being funded. And I think it's important that we make that distinction. Organisations are, you know, as I say, funded to carry out particular tasks. So I think that would be important to make that distinction, if you see what I mean.
But do you agree it represents a risk in decision making, where if an organisation's, and indeed we had confirmation of that a couple of weeks ago from the SCVO, that there is a potential risk where an organisation is receiving its funding from the Scottish Government, that they then will tell the government what they want to hear?
And
because they have fears about their line of funding.
So that's what we need to guard against. Now, what I would say is that there are many organisations, and I'm sure we could come back with a number of examples if you'd find it helpful, where you know that organisations will not hold back in criticising government policy, even when they receive funding. And that's how mm-hmm. it should be, incidentally. There should be no guard against criticising Scottish Government just because an organisation receives funding. That would be a problem if that was the case. So there, and actually, if you look back, there are many organisations that have been quite vociferous about aspects of government policy, things that we've brought forward that they don't agree with, and they receive government funding and continue to receive mm-hmm. government funding. So I hope that gives you some reassurance.
Permanent Secretary, I'll give you the chance. Question specifically is, how do you guard in process terms, in decision-making terms, cognizance of risk against policy capture?
So I think, you know, as the Deputy First Minister set it out, we do deliberately set up external scrutiny to provide that challenge. So, you know, Scottish Fiscal Commission, Audit Scotland itself. But if I think about the promise, I was at their board last week. They provide significant independent scrutiny, challenge, analysis on our care system, the promise itself, and how that's being delivered. Now, funded by the Scottish Government, but certainly not, certainly still empowered to challenge. And that's deliberate. So it is not in-house within the system, it is out with transparent, accountable, and very visible for everyone to see. I think then your more general point, which is absolutely right, you know, we need to ensure the evidence, transparency, healthy challenge is applied to public debates around the most contentious issues. And no more do we see that transparently in Parliament every week, where there's complex debates going on around justice reform, national care service, marine protected areas, deposit return schemes. You know, these are debates that are supported by evidence and data that represent a significant amount of stakeholder engagement. And my teams will try and capture that, provide impartial and objective advice to ministers, and make sure that we are listening and getting all the inputs into that policy advisory process as best we can. We'll do that through consultations, published impact assessments, structured governance that includes non-executives and independent advisory boards, and we'll use that to try and give our ministers the best possible advice to inform decisions. And then, of course, Parliament subjects that to significant scrutiny as well. So I think you're right, always got to guard against the risk of policy capture, but I think what I observe is a very healthy level of scrutiny and debate in Scotland around the difficult decisions that the country's trying to take.
I suppose my final question then, there were concerns expressed previously in the Gender Reform Recognition Bill where the term was used that it particularly as a policy, and I'm very mindful it's quite contentious. I'm not trying to make any political points here, I'm merely using it as an example of what I'm driving at. The point was made during that in the EQIAs, the Equalities Impact Assessments, that during the period of the 6 years during which this was assessed, no cognizance was given to the impact of women and girls who had been sexually assaulted or raped of having fully intact men in terms of genitalia. I mean, setting aside, you know, their right to be referred to in their chosen gender, but no consideration was given to the impact on those women of having women in their safe places. Now, I asked in gender whether they had done any assessment, and their reply was no, we did no assessment, and anyway, we wouldn't do the EQIA. So in terms of this concept around avoiding policy capture and critical friends and robust decision making, how did we in policy terms get to the position where nobody thought about that for 6 years?
Well, look, as you pointed out yourself, there was 6 years of debate and scrutiny of a policy, probably to the extent of few others have been through that level of long-term debate and scrutiny. Was everything done perfectly? Probably not. There are always lessons to be learned around all of that. What I would say is that the EQIA did look at the impact on women and girls generally. I accept what you're saying about the specific, and that's something, you know, maybe we need to reflect upon. But I think if you think about in general terms, that the level of consultation, of scrutiny, of engagement, I personally engaged with a whole range of organisations diametrically opposed, many absolutely in favour, many absolutely against. And I guess, if you're talking about organisations that have, you know, support or that receive government funding, and which side of the debate they were on during this process, I mean, I accept that there are a number of women's organisations that do receive Scottish Government funding who, you know, were in favour of this reform. But those same organisations have been very critical of the Scottish Government in other policy areas and have not held back in saying so, many in the justice field. So, you know, I think my conclusion from all of that is that we need to guard against any perception, whether it's real or not, but any perception of organisations receiving government funding, therefore taking a particular stance on issues. So we have to guard against that. But what I would say to you is I think the evidence shows that organisations are very robust in their criticism of government, even when they receive funding, and that's how it should be.
Mm. Permanent Secretary, any last comments on that? Were you surprised about my comment there?
No, I understand the level of contention around the bill and the debate in the country. I mean, I was just checking the data. So, you know, November 2017, the first consultation, 15,500 responses received. That informed development of the draft bill, detailed impact assessments, equality impact assessment, children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment, a further consultation, 17,000 responses received. And, you know, we all observed the level of debate until the lights went out before Christmas.
You've just made a comment about volume rather than quality. The point I'm making is that if during that significant volume, which I absolutely don't doubt, nobody at any point thought it was appropriate to look at from an impact perspective for women who've been sexually assaulted, which is incidentally a huge percentage of women, as you will know, or raped, of having fully intact men in their safe spaces. That says to me, from a process and risk assessment perspective, from decision making, that something wasn't right. Do you accept that? Or am I missing something? Do you accept that clearly something hadn't been quite right in the processes? Because it's not about volume, it's about quality.
Well, maybe right. Permiset can come back in a minute, but I think just to be clear on two points, I mean, the EQIA did, in terms of the top level, look at the impact on women and girls. But during the consultation and my discussions with a range of organisations, those issues were raised and they were recorded as issues that were raised during those discussions. And then I guess there is the debate that then ensued, that was clearly a matter that was raised during the process of that debate. And Parliament tried to navigate its way through all of these really difficult issues to come to a consensus and conclusion around some of these matters, none of which was easy. And obviously, you know, we've had long discussions. In fact, when I met with yourself, there were many issues raised at that stage, and trying to bring all of that and marshal all of that to a point where Parliament could make a decision was quite a difficult process. Yeah. I would say Parliament made the right decision. I know you would disagree with that, but ultimately Parliament had to make the decision based on all of the evidence in front of it in the round, and that's where Parliament landed.
I feel as though I've taken a great deal of time in this, so I want to let other colleagues come in. Thank you both.
Okay, thank you. And I have a couple of questions in this area on lessons to be learned. You mentioned, Deputy First Minister, that you said on this area, lessons are to be learned. Rather than speaking more about the specifics, how do you go about learning lessons? What are the things you have changed or done differently or would do differently, given the experience that you've just recounted with Michelle Thompson?
Well, I guess one of my reflections is, you know, was there a way of trying to build more of a consensus around the issue that I felt very strongly was important to try and do? Could we have done that at an earlier stage? Was it possible? I think the difficulty was that trying to bring people together to coalesce around compromises, I don't know what that would have looked like because the debate became so polarised, not least around social media, far more so than it was initially back 6 years ago. And when you're the minister in charge of a piece of legislation where you can see the public discourse being so polarised, the room for compromise and it becomes quite difficult. But I'm the first to reflect upon, you know, were there things that could have been done to try and do that more effectively.
It's a useful recount of that, but it's something that we hear regularly from government ministers. Lessons will be learned. So, you know, Ferries scandal, 29th of March 2022, Kate Forbes said, we recognise where things have gone wrong and we are learning lessons for the future. The First Minister at the time said lessons have been, are being and will be learned. Mm-hmm. Audit Scotland report on £5 billion, lack of transparency in the COVID business arrangements. Kate Forbes said any lessons highlighted by the report would be learned. This is about decision making, and I'm keen to understand, we're being told lessons are being learned. What are those lessons?
Well, let me come on to some of those. Obviously, the COVID inquiry will very much look at and scrutinise all aspects of how the government responded. Bearing in mind, governments responding to something that's never happened before mm-hmm. is quite challenging. There's no blueprint that you can take off a shelf to navigate through a global pandemic. So inevitably, things were done at speed in a way that, you know, looking in hindsight and having the ability to look back in hindsight, would you do those in normal time or would you do things differently? So I absolutely accept lessons need to be learned, because if we have another global pandemic, we will have the experience of what worked and perhaps what didn't work.
So the
full public inquiry will come up with recommendations yeah. around some of that, which all governments yeah, need to...
So maybe a couple of other examples then are the Ferries scandal, which I've mentioned, huge amounts of public expenditure. The census, shambolic approach to the census. Nicola Sturgeon said on 1st of June 2022, of course we'll review the experience and ensure that any lessons that are required to be learned are learned. So what lessons have we learned about how these pretty poor decisions made by this government were made?
So let's come back to Ferries before we move on to the census. And the Section 22 report was a hugely important report, and a number of changes flowed from that, not least the governance arrangements at Ferguson's itself. Huge difference, and Perm Sec can go into more detail if required, but a complete overhaul of the governance arrangements that flowed from that, and that was important that happened at speed, and it did happen at speed. So in terms of lessons learned, it wasn't just a kind of at some point in the future lessons will be learned. It was a very rapid response, and with improved governance arrangements in rapid time. In terms of the census, there were obviously in terms of Scotland choosing to take forward and the Scottish Government making a decision to carry out the census in a different way that then did lead to some challenges around the participation rate. And again, the work that was undertaken at speed to address some of that in order to get that figure up actually worked, and the figure became one that could then be relied upon in terms of the census return. And of course, again, yes, I mean, I guess it would be a strange situation for a government not to learn lessons, even when things go well, and it's not on the list of what about this and what about that. Even when things go well and delivery is good, there are always lessons to be learned around how things might be improved going forward.
So for instance, on the census, we'll not do that again, will we? We'll keep the census at the same time as the rest of the UK. Is that the case?
Well,
is that a lesson that's been learned?
Well, I think there were advantages and disadvantages. So one of the advantages around the content of the census and being able to do the and carry out the census according to when we felt that was the best time has some advantages. The disadvantage was the UK-wide publicity around the census. So those judgments, and bring the Perm Sec in on some of the detail around that, those judgments will be made absolutely looking at the pros and cons of whether that is the best thing to do. Clearly, the most important thing with the census is having a return at a level that's then reliable. So that's the top thing.
And that was a big failure in that regard. So, Permanent Secretary, well, I mean, on that point, on this idea of the census, I mean, is that something you and your officials have reflected on? We've been told that lessons are being learned. What's the central lesson that you learned?
So, if we start with the census, Deputy First Minister is right. We're confident, we've worked with Office for National Statistics, that the census process will provide reliable data and output to serve our needs. And National Records Scotland worked very hard in a difficult context with the pandemic, still high COVID infection rates through the spring of last year to get that done. Clearly, I think there is the opportunity for us to provide advice for ministers on what happens next time. Hopefully, we won't be trying to do the census in a period that is still very much behaviours impacted by the pandemic. And there has already been significant learning derived through the process of delivering the census in Scotland around how we use different data models to get to the right confidence interval for the outputs. And we can certainly take away a request if the committee would like us to set out precisely what the lessons are for next time around how we would take this on again. I think just to come back to your more general question of how do you learn and how do we know the learning is driving improvement, I think one of the critical things we want to continue to do is to publish the changes and for transparency where we deliver improvements. So if we take private investments, last time I was before this committee last year, the challenge was, are you going to get that published? We have published that private investment framework. That's an important benchmark from the learning from Ferguson's, but also from La Caba and Prestwick and other private asset investments. And that now is the consistent standard that we want to follow for the future. It's about how we use independent expert commercial advisors, how we ensure that informs decision-making, how we ensure that, back to the original question, the decisions are subject to scrutiny and diverse input and advice. But I think your main point, are you learning, are you improving? We need to prove that, set it out openly, and then make progress accordingly.
Okay, Liz Smith.
Thank you, good morning. Deputy First Minister, as you know, we took evidence from 15 former ministers and former civil servants, and the former ministers represented three different political parties who'd obviously been in government over recent times. And they were quite unequivocal in their views that at times too much decision-making is seen to be, and I quote, rushed, unclear and unstructured. Do you agree with that?
No, that's not been my experience, I have to say. Sometimes, actually, it can feel the opposite. The decision sometimes can be frustratingly long to make, and that you, sometimes you will get advice that you go through, and you will go through a number of times. You will have lots of discussion around the various options that are being put in front of you, and that can take some time, even when there's an eagerness to get on and do what is in front of you. In terms of where you have a situation that requires a very quick turnaround. So in my opening remarks, I mentioned the response to Ukraine, the COVID pandemic, that sometimes rapid decision making is required when you're facing out of the ordinary situations. That doesn't mean it shouldn't still be good decision making, but it does mean that you have to do that in quick time and rely upon the best evidence, the best advice that can be brought to you. Some of it you can rely upon experience, previous decisions that have been made, what were the outcomes to those, but sometimes it's new and it's things that are that there's nothing to draw upon, and therefore that requires judgment to be brought, and sometimes that judgment will be the right judgment, but with hindsight and some decision making, clearly it wasn't, but it'll be the best judgment made on the best evidence at the time. So I mean, I've been a minister in government kind of on and off for kind of more or less 15 years. And what I would say is that when you gain confidence and experience as a minister, that enables you to make decisions perhaps more quickly, and to be able to challenge some of the advice that comes in front of you a bit more readily than a minister that perhaps doesn't have that experience and might therefore quite rightly take longer. So I don't recognise that, and I can only go, I'm afraid, by my own experience in government over that time.
Thank you. I mean, ironically, I think when it comes to current civil servants, they were making the case that on issues like COVID and Ukraine, decision-making was actually quite good because it was so desperately urgent and so serious that things actually worked out pretty well. But the former ministers and former civil servants who were pre-COVID and pre-Ukraine, they were arguing very forcibly that there are far too many decisions that were seen as not particularly good because they were so unstructured. And I think this morning we've already had the gender recognition situation flagged up. We've had issues about ferries, we've had BIFAB, we've had Prestwick, we've had the census. Add on to that the DRS, HPMEs, the National Care Service. I mean, the list goes on for the Scottish Government of concerns about effective decision-making, because I think in all these cases, I'm sure that the Scottish Government would argue they could have done things better. And I think our concern as a committee is that the Scottish Government is perhaps not listening carefully enough to the stakeholders who are on the front line of delivering these policies, because, as I say, the Scottish Government's record on a lot of these issues has not been very good. Would you accept that?
So let me take a few of those issues. I don't think anyone could say that decision-making around GRR was rushed. I mean, this was a prolonged policy over a long period of time. I wouldn't accept it was unstructured either. I think we've got to make a distinction between things that are politically contentious and that people disagree with, and decision-making that is made on the best available evidence at the time. Now, if you take DRS, when the DRS scheme was first mooted and introduced, of course, that predated the issue of the Internal Market Act coming into being as a factor. So a process was set in place, and then an external factor came in to being that became actually very fundamental to the scheme, but nobody could have predicted that was going to be the case at the start of taking forward DRS. So some things are within your influence and your power, but sometimes there'll be things that come that are not. Now, in terms of your point about stakeholders, I think that's a fair point. DRS is quite an interesting example where you look at the larger businesses. They were able, maybe because of their capacity, to get things in place quite rapidly, whereas what became apparent was that small businesses were struggling with that, probably because they didn't have the same capacity to be able to put in place the arrangements that the larger ones had. If I reflect on my own decision-making, if you take the short-term licensing scheme, again, politically contentious. Some people disagreed with the principle and some agreed with it. But in terms of the implementation, on the basis of actually the very same thing, that that businesses were saying they needed more time for some of the practicalities. In that case, things like getting tradespeople in to the property to do some of the assessments. As soon as I became aware of the extent of that, that's when we made the decision to extend the deadline to October. Is that a failure of decision-making in the first place? I would actually say it's not. I would say it's being able to respond to something, and a movable situation, that evidence has come in front of you that was the right decision to take to delay. And I would say that was an example of listening and changing the scheme in response to listening to those concerns, rather than it being a weakness and a poor decision making. So,
I'm not sure I would accept that, but let's try and keep the politics aside of that. When it comes to the National Care Service, there are four committees of this Parliament who have raised very serious concerns about the National Care Service, because they don't feel that the evidence has reflected the views of people on the front line. And certainly this committee has had very serious issues about the lack of a financial memorandum. Still have very considerable concerns about that. Does that not flag up to you that there are serious issues for the government because it has not consulted effectively with all stakeholders? And as I say, it has resulted in, it's very unusual, and certainly in my time in this Parliament, it's very unusual for four committees to have very serious concerns, and we still don't have an accurate financial memorandum.
So the National Care Service is a hugely complex piece of reform. And I guess, in terms of the stakeholder views, there are actually quite different stakeholder views on the National Care Service. Some stakeholders, who you might describe as being those representing service user interests, are very much in favour of progress of the National Care Service at pace, because they don't feel that the current arrangements for delivering social care meet their needs. And if you speak to them as a group of stakeholders, they will urge and the government, and actually were expressed some disappointment due to the delay, that the government wasn't getting on and making those reforms. The other group of stakeholders, local government in particular, have a differing view for all the reasons that we understand. They believe that local decision-making and local control is important. One of the key reasons that we've taken a step back is that trying to do and take this forward in the face of those local government concerns would be very, very challenging indeed. I'm a big fan of the National Care Service, having been a former home care organiser, and I could speak for the rest of the committee session about that and why I think national standards and a national framework are really important to have the same quality and standards everywhere, but I'll just leave that for the moment. Taking and agreeing a way forward with local government has become the primary consideration here, for all the reasons that I think we understand, that trying to move this big reform forward without trying to reach a consensus and compromise with local government would be just really, really difficult. So that's why the decision has been made to create that space over the summer to try and reach an agreement and compromise with local government. And the financial memorandum that will be brought back will reflect what that decision making looks like in terms of how we take it forward. There will need to be changes to the plan, the way it's going to be delivered and the way it will be rolled out. That's going to be inevitable. But I hope that helps to explain that, it's not through the lack of intent and firm belief that a National Care Service can actually make things better for people, but the implementation of it is crucial. It's crucial that's done in the right way, and taking local government with us is important.
Deputy First Minister, that there was another comment made by the former ministers and former civil servants who said that for some financial rules which normally we would have as standard practice for decision making are have found on some occasions to be optional, and that's a quote. That is a concern for this committee, that some proper practice of the financial management of policies is sometimes not adhered to properly. Is that a concern for the Scottish Government?
Well, I think I'll bring Perm Sec in a moment. So the financial decision making is crucial, and the transparency of that is absolutely crucial as well. At the end of the day, this is public money and the decision making around that. So that couldn't be more important. Again, in my experience, the decision making around financial matters is robust. Sometimes there are clearly options around which financial option you would take in terms of the level of investment, the profiling of funding, all of those. There's a judgment to be applied there around the best outcomes and best value for money. But in terms of some of the improvements that have been made around this issue, there's been extensive work done. The Perm Sec, I think, would be happy just to give a bit of detail on that.
Yeah, and happy to write to the committee with a bit more detail on this, because it's not optional. And so if there's evidence that it was in the past or an example can be shared, then we would look into that for sure. So all expenditure above £1 million, I personally sign off, and so does the Deputy First Minister at the moment because of the fiscal position. So we call these our accountable officer templates. So for all expenditure, I am checking to be confident that it's proper, regular, lawful, parliamentary authority is in place, that the commercial considerations have been properly taken account of, and those inputs go into those templates, and the Chief Finance Officer and I provide assurance to the Deputy First Minister that spending is optimal and the right thing to do given the context we're in. We try to take that discipline through the organisation and through our finance business partner networks, ensure that we are clear in understanding where our expenditure is happening and that we're confident it is optimal. It always matters, but it particularly matters given the tight fiscal position that we've been in since inflation has been so high.
Okay, thank you for that. I just would urge you to reflect on what the Auditor General has said about public finance and the need for additional scrutiny and transparency, because, as you know, he's not been very comfortable about that. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. When Liz Smith raised this issue with you in the Chamber, Deputy First Minister, you said that the advice that we commission and receive is the best advice available to ministers. I mean, that would include legal advice. Mm-hmm. What are the circumstances when making a decision that you would decide to disregard legal advice that you'd received?
Well, legal advice is hugely important. I don't think I have ever disregarded legal advice ever because of its importance. What I would say is that legal advice is often around options. It's not always black and white. It quite often says there's this, there's this, there's this, there's this, and these are the various scenarios in terms of the legal advice being given. But as a minister, I have never set aside legal advice.
So there was advice in relation to the case surrounding the former First Minister, Alex Hammond, that former First Minister, it was discounted by the Scottish Government. And the advice stated that the advice was to concede in the case, and said they were unable to see the benefits in proceeding come close to meeting the potential detriments in doing so. So at some point, the Cabinet has made a decision to disregard that legal advice. I'm concerned about and want to understand how you would have that conversation in Cabinet and come to a decision to set aside that advice and do something else.
I wasn't party to any discussion in Cabinet.
Permanent Secretary?
Well, Permanent Secretary wouldn't have been.
Maybe ahead of before your time?
Yeah, well, it's before my time, but let's stick with the principle of your question. So we would never disregard legal advice, of course. It's imperative we understand, is it proper, is it regular, is it lawful? Leslie's legal team do an incredible job and are very integrated with the senior leadership of our executive team in all the work that we're doing. As Deputy First Minister says, it isn't always binary, so it's lawful to do this and not to do that. It's a judgment and a balance of risk. And ultimately, ministers are quite entitled to look at wider strategic considerations, whether that be about economic benefits, formal, informal, reputational risks, or whatever. But as an accountable officer, particularly when it comes back to the point around public expenditure, it has to be proper and regular for me to be confident and to authorise it. Otherwise, I can't. That's what the public duty under the Scottish Public Finance Act requires me to do. And the same would be true in terms of expenditure, for example, on the legal case. So it wouldn't be feasible, or it wouldn't be proper and regular, to pursue that if there was no authority to do so, or source of public funds, or whatever.
Okay. Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks very much. Continuing maybe on the theme of a speed of decision-making, to be frank, we have had very mixed views from different witnesses that we've had here. And, for example, if we take COVID, we had some witnesses said it was great, it was quick and decisive and all that kind of thing. But then others said, and especially from some women's groups, it was too fast and there wasn't enough consultation. And I have to say, I share your experience generally that decision-making can be quite slow. We also had evidence from business that they make a decision when they're kind of 80% certain about something. And their kind of suggestion was government waits till it's 90, 95, 99% certain before making a decision. So I just wonder, is it that it has to be a different speed for different decisions, or are there principles in there? How do you get the balance?
I mean, it is a difficult balance, and you're then looking at the carrying of risk. So if you have the advice in front of you, and it is the best advice, but nothing's ever 100% certain, and everything carries a risk. So if you've got three options in front of you, those relative risks will be set out to you, and a recommendation, not always, but quite often, will be made by civil servants who have drawn on the experience that they will have brought in order to present that to ministers in terms of those the relative risks of all of those options. And then ultimately, again, it's you have to apply some judgment to that. In terms of the speed of, and you're right, I mean, you'll hear quite differing views, some criticism of things taking too long, and other times, you know, an accusation of too rapid a decision making and not looking at the... I think the truth of it is that differing decisions will require differing timeframes and analysis. Personally, and again, I'm having to draw on, I guess, some of my personal experience here. If I look at something and I'm just not sure around the relative risks, and it just isn't clear to me, then I wouldn't make a decision on the basis of the submission in front of me. I would firstly probably call all the officials into a meeting so I can probe more fully what lies behind some of the assumptions, some of the risk analysis. And that way you can really get in behind what inevitable lies behind a, you know, six-page submission. And that takes time. But it's better to take that time so that you can make a decision with the full facts in front of you and understanding all of that. So that is how I go about decision making, and all of the kind of frameworks and the standards that that the PERM set mentioned earlier on are, you know, are, I guess, are in, there to ensure the quality of the advice that's coming up. I think just one final point. I mean, civil servants can't, you know, nobody can be an expert on everything. So inevitably, you're drawing on, you know, business community, on other stakeholders that have a level of knowledge, experience, view, and you're trying to draw all of that in to try and make the best decision on the information in front of you.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. I mean, it's been good that we've had evidence from such a wide range of witnesses, and can I particularly say we appreciated meeting existing civil servants up at St Andrew's House, which was, I think, a slightly unusual experience for all of us, but was actually very good and they were very helpful. On the issue of transparency, about how transparent, you know, advice should be, I mean, you mentioned transparency yourself in your opening remarks, and most of us would say transparency is a great thing. We did have some, I think, previous civil servants and ministers saying you can have a bit too much, because if everything's written down, if all the advice is written down for transparency, then it's very difficult for a civil servant to give, you know, confidential advice or options or that kind of thing in a more general sense. Mm-hmm. And I just wonder how, again, you feel we get the balance in that space.
Well, I think the presumption is on transparency, and that, you know, that anything that is influencing your decision should be part of that submission. Now, you know, clearly, in discussions with civil servants, they will, you know, bring all those inherent risks alive by, you know, telling you kind of what lies behind the submission, that, you know, that group of stakeholders are vehemently opposed because of X, Y, and Z, or this group of stakeholders will be fully in favour of that because of A, B, and C. And that sometimes that's where judgments are quite difficult to make, because you know that none of the options are going to please everybody, and you're going to have a group of stakeholders who think absolutely that's the wrong decision. And in trying to come to a conclusion, you know, well, what's the objective? What is it that you're trying to achieve, and that the submission is trying to give you advice on taking forward a particular policy? And you've got to try and navigate through that. And ultimately, sometimes you need to make a decision in the full knowledge that it's not going to please a particular group of stakeholders.
Yes. I do understand that bit. I just wonder, do you think sometimes civil servants are reluctant to give advice or frank advice because it's all going to be written down and it might come back and haunt them?
I mean, I'm going to draw on Perm Sec in a minute. I would hope not, because, you know, if it's critical advice that could sway a decision, it really ought to be in there. Now, I guess that thing about what you're getting at is full and frank and free advice from civil servants. Does it become compromised if civil servants think that they're going to be held in front of a committee and made to answer for it, you know, a couple of years down the line because it didn't work out as had been planned? I would hope that's not the case, because as ministers, ultimately, we rely on a kind of honest picture in all warts and all, rather than something that is refined because they think it will sit easier with ministers. So I would prefer the warts and all, and I think that would be my starting point.
No, you know, we hold dear the values of honesty, objectivity, impartiality. Our job is to provide ministers with the very best advice. So we expect that to be robust, evidence-led. It needs to have all the right inputs to it, whether it be finance, legal, commercial, or whatever. We talked about the importance of listening. So we were just having a look on the way down here in terms of public consultations. You know, we've got a dozen live at the minute. We undertake around 80 to 90 public consultations a year. And then in terms of being transparent around the impacts of decisions, being taken. You know, if I take business regulatory impact assessments, we've done around 10 of those since January this year. In April alone, we've done a quality impact assessments around carers, procurement, justice reform, fair work, health and social care. So I think our job is to ensure that the advice is as robust and as objective and as impartial as possible to give ministers the options and the understanding of the risks and benefits of the choices available to them. But I do also understand the point that you heard from colleagues in that private discussion. You know, politics, as you guys know better than anyone, is an intense business. Social media has added to all of that. And the level of public scrutiny on some of the issues we've discussed today, whether it be gender recognition reform or deposit return scheme or social care reform, they are all contentious. And so part of our job is to build a culture where people feel safe and supported to have those honest conversations and to also do their jobs in a safe and secure way where we look after their well-being. And Leslie can say a bit more if you're interested with regards to that in terms of the harassment reviews and continuous improvement programme, the work we're trying to do to build well-being and to build that professionalism so that colleagues feel absolutely supported to provide advice, even if it's not what people want to hear necessarily. Because as DFM says, it's much better to hear it early, hear it with full honesty, warts and all, than pretend we're all fine and then derail later. So we're trying to really encourage transparency within the organisation, the escalation of risk early, and absolutely that objective advice for ministers to make optimal choices.
OK, I can maybe ask something else, and then maybe Ms Fraser can come in if she wants. Does the relationship between the minister and the civil servants matter? And does it vary a lot? Because we have got the impression that in some cases a minister can be quite overpowering, let's say, and forces the civil servants to do what they might not want to do. And on the other hand, sometimes the minister's quite weak and just follows what the civil servants want. So, I mean, is that something we should worry about, that there's a big variety in views? And tied in with that, sorry to put it all together, but
that's right.
the whole thing about churn, both churn of civil servants, changing quite often so the minister doesn't know who they're speaking to, but also a churn of ministers sometimes quite often and the civil servant doesn't know who they're speaking to.
Okay. Can I just come in first while this is in my head? The relationship doesn't matter. So you'll have, and it's just human nature being human nature, you will build up a particular relationship with key officials who you become to rely upon. And who you, human nature being that again, that you will maybe be your go-to civil servants because you've had good advice, clear, sound advice previously. So, you know, that, and in every ministerial job I've had, that's how it's panned out. There's an important thing in what you've said about ministers' behaviour. So we cannot have a position where civil servants would be wary about putting difficult advice in front of a minister because of the reaction they might get, because that then can lead to poor decision making. So it's critically important that, you know, ministerial behaviour is such that ministers have to accept that sometimes they will get information, it's something they've absolutely wanted to do and it's just not doable for all the good reasons that are set out in front of you, and sometimes you just have to accept that because it's the best advice being provided to you. So that is important. And you know, the civil service support of, you know, particularly senior civil servants, who are the ones who are interacting with ministers more often, it's important that there's absolutely a respect and culture that respects, that relationship is not always one of equals, and that, you know, and ministers have to recognise that in the way that they respond sometimes to news that they're not that happy about. And, you know, we've all had that, but it's important that, you know, civil servants at the end of the day are only providing you with the best advice that they possibly can. JP.
our members just have a few more members to get round, so if we can ask for brevity in answers a little bit before. I understand it's a broad subject, but if we can try and narrow it down a little bit. Apologies.
Yep, sure. Thank you. And just to pick up that point about the wider culture and values, and I think this is a point of lessons that the organisation has very much learned. So our vision and values that we introduced as an organisation in the Service of Scotland in 2021 was really recognising that for our diverse colleagues in the organisation to be able to bring their whole selves to work, we need to create that safe environment. So as well as our civil service values, that builds on collaboration, innovation, inclusion and kindness. And that's then taken through into the way that we train civil servants into the skills and expertise and behaviours that we're looking for in our senior civil servants, for example. I'm very happy to provide a bit more information on that, if that would be useful. Thank you.
Ask on this, we've talked about a warts and all policy. I think too often I hear in conversations of particularly the most controversial decisions that have been made, instances of minutes not being taken in meetings. So we had that in relation to both the Ferguson Marine scandal, we've several occasions, in relation to, again, that the instance of the former First Minister, minutes not being taken between Scottish Government officials and lawyers and others. What action has the Permanent Secretary taken to ensure that never happens again?
Well, we set out quite a lot of actions that we need to take, convener, and Leslie maybe can just briefly do a bit more on the detail, because as you say, those historic examples are regrettable. We've said that before, and we, you know, want to make sure that absolutely safe space for that challenge and level of honest debate, but then also a clear record of the decision. Leslie has been leading a lot of significant work on record keeping. We've revised our guidance for our private office for our ministers around the level of decisions, changing our systems on retrievals for documents as well, and then we're sharing all of that for transparency. But okay. Is there anything more
Please.
You want to add?
Yeah, we have set in place a whole information and governance programme in response to the issues that were identified and the improvements that we wanted to make. And of course, we're not alone as an organisation in wrestling with, you know, really enormous amounts of data and information at the moment, so critical that we get this right. So the Information Management Board, which I now chair, has been meeting for the last 18 months. We've trained lots of our colleagues across the organisation, almost 2,500, increased their skills. We have put in place new systems in government as well, so that we can more quickly and accurately locate information when we need to find it, and ensure that colleagues are properly trained in terms of how that should be put in place. So there's a whole culture, systems and practice really that's absolutely essential here, and just linking this back with everyone's core civil service craft. It's the very essence of being a really good public servant.
Thank you. And Deputy First Minister, does the Cabinet recognise this culture and that it has to be adopted? So, for instance, May 2017, the meeting between Nicola Sturgeon and Jim McCall to discuss issues at Ferguson Marine, a very, very significant issue in terms of huge public expenditure and waste, no minute taken. Do you and your colleagues recognise that it's completely unacceptable for that practice to be undertaken, for no records to be taken, in recognition of what your colleagues are saying?
Well, of course, ministers have supported all of the improvements and that have been made that you've just heard the detail of. Regularly in my inbox, I will have minutes that have come through very rapidly of not just meetings with external organisations, but with officials around decision making, all recorded in terms of the minute of that meeting. So everything is minuted, and that's how it should be. Are you know, if you're asking me, is that always been the case? And Well, no, and you've just heard why those improvements were put in place because of concerns, one of which you've just highlighted. And having those minutes is extremely helpful for ministers, apart from anything else, and being able to refer back.
So you think that the colleagues won't undertake those kind of practices again in the Cabinet?
Well, the processes are the processes, so minutes are
part of the... To be fair, Deputy First Minister, there was processes in place beforehand as well.
Well,
there was...
not to the extent that they are now, that you've heard about the changes that have been made. Yeah. So minutes are now required and are taken in every single one of those circumstances. And as I say, my inbox regularly, every minute of every meeting that I've had for the previous day,
You seem reluctant to say that that would be your expectation of Cabinet colleagues.
Oh,
that they
of course
would do
it's the expectation of every Minister. Excellent. And every Cabinet
Glad
Secretary. Absolutely.
Okay. Ross
Greer.
Thank you, Convener. The Auditor General's recent reports around the gap between policy ambition and delivery, I think, would resonate with all of us. And it also relates to the issue of fiscal sustainability that this committee has been wrestling with and that I know that the government's been wrestling with. I think it comes into relevance for this inquiry, though, when we talk particularly around, as has been mentioned, churning the civil service. Part of that is civil servants being spread increasingly thin, being moved from one team to another because new initiatives, new policies have been adopted. And that creates not just a lack of capacity, but a lack of expertise, and potentially in some cases a lack of the depth of robust advice that ministers might want to have. So if I could kind of round all that up into one question: is the Scottish Government overcommitted? Are we trying to do too much for the resources we've got, and that is resulting in that gap between ambition and what's actually being delivered?
So there are a number of factors pressing on our public finances. One is absolutely that we have a huge number of programmes, all of which need to be supported, and a financial position which has come under increasing pressure. The position of the level of inflation, for example, has of course squeezed the budget and meant that the value and purchasing power of every pound of Scottish public finances has significantly reduced. If you add on to that the pay deals, which of course nobody would deny any public servant a reasonable pay deal, but of course we've had to fund that by and large through the resources available to us, and that's meant some difficult decisions. We saw that in terms of teachers' pay and the decision that had to be made around the £46 million for universities and colleges, and we said at the time that that money had to come from somewhere. So these are, you know, real decisions and real issues that have to be navigated. The medium-term financial strategy that I will be bringing to Parliament soon will set out the horizon scan of what the public finances are looking like and some of the difficult decisions that will require to be made. And ultimately, one of the reasons that the First Minister set out the missions were that we need to look at everything we do and everything we spend money on through that lens to really ask ourselves some quite difficult questions, perhaps. Does it deliver those key missions? And that will have to guide us through some of the quite difficult decisions that will inevitably have to be made in order to balance the budget. The Scottish Government has to balance the budget. It's a legal requirement. We have no option. So therefore, my job is to make sure that my colleagues are doing what they can to address all of those issues, including the programming. The point about civil servants, of course, it is difficult for civil servants that one minute they're working on this, the next they're working on that, but the skill of the civil service, what I've seen in my experience, is that they're very quick to adapt, they're agile, they're able to get to grips with new policy areas. And I think there is just a recognition that, you know, we have to keep a close eye on headcount, and we can't have exponential growth, and that means that it has to be an agile organisation, and that civil servants will have to pivot like they did on Ukraine, for example. No one knew how to set up a Ukraine resettlement programme, and it was actually an amazing insight, I think, into how the civil servants, the civil service is agile, is experienced, and is able to deal with something that no one could have predicted in a very efficient and professional and manner that has delivered a good scheme.
Okay, Roscoe.
Thanks, DFM. If I could kind of drill down on that a little bit then, just I'll try to be brief here. Would the outcomes be better if the Scottish Government was doing less, but doing each of those initiatives with more resources available to it? Because at the moment, there's a huge number of resources, a huge number of priorities spread across a range of initiatives, and we know there's this gap between ambition and outcome. Would the outcomes across the board, particularly in terms of child poverty, net zero, would they be better if there were fewer programmes, but those programmes were being resourced better?
So this is one of the pieces of work that's absolutely critical.
Please.
We are taking that forward, yes.
Yeah, just reiterate my plea for brevity.
Yes. Please.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
And just finally, the resource spending review last year was supposed to get us towards a point of fiscal sustainability. Obviously, that happened during a period where inflation was continuing to rise. But reflecting on the fact that we had the RSR in the summer and then in the autumn an emergency budget review, a second round of additional savings, it appeared to me that quite a lot of what was in the EBR probably could have been in the resource spending review. Has there been any lessons learned exercise into why the RSR didn't generate some of the kind of savings in the EBR that, certainly when I was looking at it, felt relatively obvious? Some of what was in the EBR was painful and difficult, but not all of it.
So there's maybe a fair point there, but I do think the pay deals were something that came at us due to the rise of inflation. Those pay demands and therefore the pay deals that ultimately were to try and avoid industrial action, quite rightly, were beyond perhaps what had been envisaged in terms of the RSR, and that put additional pressure on the budget, and the money's got to come from somewhere. So part of the EBR process was to help, and the former DFM laid that out, that one of the driving forces, of course, were the pay deals driven by inflation. That's quite hard to predict, to be honest, but we absolutely want to avoid being in EBR territory again this year, and that's why I'm undertaking the work I am with Cabinet colleagues to manage those in-year pressures.
My point on the EBR is more that it appears that certainly some of the decisions that were made in the EBR to withdraw and cut services haven't had a negative impact in terms of outcomes, which begs the question of, was that the right thing to be spending money on in the first place? The RSR was the kind of exercise that should have been identifying, should have been asking those value for money questions. But certainly in the case of quite a lot of what was on the EBR list, clearly the RSR hadn't done that, or had done that and had taken the decision that actually it was value for money. Then through the EBR we decided it wasn't, or it wasn't enough value to justify continuing it. Mm-hmm. Does that not indicate that the RSR exercise didn't achieve all of its objectives?
I mean, you maybe have a fair point there. I think that, you know, the exercise we're going through at the moment is very much looking at value for money, impact, does it deliver on outcomes, and we're really trying to land that in the right place for short-term fiscal balance. But on the longer term, some of the points you were making earlier about, you know, what is it that's absolutely critical, what are the things that maybe don't deliver on those outcomes that we need to take a hard look at, and that's the work that's underway at the moment.
Thank you. That's Convener.
Thank you. Keith Brown.
Hey, thanks very much. And just to say, I'm a new member of the committee, and when Liz Smith says that our concerns as a committee, I'm not included in that. I disassociate myself from the remarks that Liz Smith made. However, and I was a bit surprised that we've gone down the route of the GRR, but let's stick with that for a second. If you have a policy which is in not just the government's manifesto, but everybody's manifesto, if you have two consultations, if you amend, if you have more parliamentary scrutiny than any other measure that I can remember in my time in this parliament, if you have all those things, and at the end of that process, you have a situation where another government says we're going to nullify that. What kind of effect, to me, it's the biggest development we've seen in public administration or decision making in this parliament, certainly in my time, in fact, I think since its inception. If another government just steps in without saying what it thinks is wrong with it and says we're going to strike this down, apart from that, and incredibly, some people in this Parliament support that government doing that to this Parliament. What is the effect on the civil service and on ministers when considering further policy initiatives of that threat, which has been raised again in relation now to a couple of other things, DRS, for example? What is the effect on policymaking in the Scottish Government of that kind of interference in the Scottish Parliament?
So I think you raise an important point. And let me just say, obviously, I'm not going to stray into kind of live legal proceedings, but obviously one of the reasons that we felt it was important to challenge the Section 35 order was that issue of precedence and the chilling effect potentially on other policies, because it's such a wide-ranging power that essentially it could be brought to bear on any policy decision-making of the Scottish Government that is not liked and not agreed with by the UK Government. And that is actually goes very much against the memorandum of understanding that had been in place, where Section 35 order was to be seen as a last resort if everything else had failed position, and that's not what happened in that case. It was a kind of go-to first salvo, and that completely blows out of the water the memorandum of understanding. So where does that leave us? I think we have to be very guarded against the chilling effect of, you know, not wanting to take forward policies in case that the UK government would disagree with. We have to guard ourselves against that, because there will be, you know, continue to be policies that we want to take forward that the UK government may fundamentally disagree with. And you know, if we believe it's in the interests of the people of Scotland and it's areas that we've set out a commitment to take forward, then we should. I would just raise the question: if we were sitting putting through minimum unit pricing at the moment, that would be a good example of where you would have the UK government who did not agree with minimum unit pricing. You could see how they could use either Section 35 or indeed the Internal Market Act to say this would be a disruptor to the drinks industry, and therefore we are not going to allow it. We're in territory which is new. It is a huge concern. We need to get a different relationship where I would say the memorandum of understanding territory would be very helpful. And that is something we will continue to pursue with the UK government, to try and get away from the kind of threats of, you know, not granting the exemption under the IMA or the Section 35 order. It's not a good place, and actually gets in the way of the good day-to-day working relationship that civil servants have with their UK counterparts, and indeed that we have with some ministers. I would finish on this point that actually I have a good relationship with a lot of the departmental ministers in the UK government. A lot of the problem emanates from the Scotland office, and I'll just leave that there.
And just maybe for the permanent secretary in relation to this, in addition, and it may well have been the case that in the inquiry the committee has held up to now, these to me, which are by far the biggest impact on decision-making in the Scottish Parliament, have been covered already. But aside from a capricious government deciding for political reasons to try and supersede a decision of this Parliament gratuitously, there are, of course, the various instances of LCMs being, the Seoul Convention being ignored now, which wasn't the case, you know, not too long ago. Does that not also have, especially in the early stages of policy development amongst the civil service, a chilling effect such that you have to take into account, as well as all the other factors, the likelihood that some minister in the Westminster government is going to do something which completely ignores the interests of this Parliament, or is going to increase the likelihood of legal conflict between the two administrations? Is that something that's part of your thinking, or is, as the DFM has just said, do you try and zone that out of your thinking at the start?
So, look, it is a complexity, and so I can't pretend that we're zoning out from it. You know, it is the reality that we're operating in terms of Section 35 being used for the first time and navigating, for example, an exemption from the UK Internal Market Act with regards implementation of the deposit return scheme, which is sort of top priority conversation at the moment with the UK government. I think we will always endeavour, back to the policy development process, to ensure that we're giving ministers the very best frank advice that we can. Go back 5 years, that wouldn't have included the risk of Section 35 or an exemption not being granted under the UK Internal Market Act, which are two new things that have occurred in the last period. So there's quite a premium on me and my team to manage those relationships to ensure that we have got the best possible understanding between both governments. And as the Deputy First Minister said, the dialogue on a four nations basis, the Deputy First Minister has had with the Chief Secretary, for example, and with Michael Gove and others, is very helpful. And we collaborate on a lot of things like green free ports and Ukraine and COVID and energy reform. But there are these points of contention and we need to navigate them with care, particularly given both those bits of legislation, both GRR and DRS, were considered within competence of this Parliament, and that wasn't disputed by anybody.
Douglas Thompson.
Thanks, Kamira. I just want to go over a few things again. First thing was something you'd raised, Kamira, about lessons learned. As a committee, how can we get assurance that the lesson learned process is actually in place? Is it visible for people to see what those lessons were? And then we can go back and check it's been done and not just a tick box exercise.
So they'll be visible in different ways depending on what the issue was. So in terms of some of the governance arrangements around Ferguson's, for example, the visibility is that there's a completely different governance structure in terms of how decisions are made there. Through to the minutes that we talked about earlier on, and everything's recorded in a proper, punctual, accurate way, and that is there for the record. So I guess that is visibility of lessons learned. I suppose in terms of decision making around, you know, judgments will always have to end up being judgments around policy decisions. Hopefully most of the time that will be the right judgment, but occasionally it will not.
But is there a document that happens after, you know, a project or a piece of work has taken place? Right, these are the lessons we learn. Yeah. I can understand what you're saying, that changes were made, but is there actually a captured list of things that went wrong and lessons to be learned?
So some of that will be on a more formal basis than others. So if you look at COVID, obviously, big public inquiry around that, very high profile, very in depth. If you look at Ferguson's, there's been a commitment that in terms of once 801 and 802 are delivered, that there would be a further inquiry looking back, even on top of what's already been done around the Audit Scotland in Section 22. So there's still work to be done there that will generate further information and lessons learned in a very in-depth way. Mm-hmm. In other areas, there'll be a kind of more rapid analysis of has that worked, and PermSec can say a little bit more about that it will be kind of shorter and sharper. Ukraine, again, there'll be an in-depth analysis of what has gone well, where there are lessons learned, partly because it's a new thing. How did the civil service and ministers respond? So all of that will be captured. PermSec, I don't know if there's...
I think you covered it, DFM. So a lot of it we will take on either recommendations or inputs around learning, evaluate those and publish our response. If there is a particular tangible area where the committee in recommendations wants to see us go further, we're happy to do that. And then, of course, we have significant programme of structured evaluation of policy. So we mentioned minimum unit pricing, recent evaluation, both independent analysis confirming good impact that has had in terms of saving lives. So we will keep trying to make sure that whether it be record keeping or private investments or, you know, our approach on freedom of information with the Information Commissioner that we're transparent about what we're doing and how we're trying to improve it.
I understand, you know, when there's an official inquiry or something, then there'll be lessons probably published by an external body. Things like the census, for example. Where's the lessons? Where can I go and see what lessons were learned there and what actions were put in place to try and make sure it doesn't happen again?
So, covered that a bit earlier. Happy to take away the process of where we've got to with the lessons learned exercise that has been ongoing, because we haven't yet concluded all the analysis of the data and the timetable for when we can publish that. Like you, I would want that to be open and transparent for scrutiny from Parliament, from committees, and on the record for the future.
But is the process in place for that to happen, or is that something that's going to be put in place?
Yeah, so I have seen various iterations of lessons learned census-related documents already. The thing I don't have is the timetable for when it will become published, but we can provide that to the committee.
Okay. Thank you. Can I go on now to critical challenge? Michelle Thompson mentioned earlier about we had SCVO in, and they said there is a risk. They feel, or their members felt, that there's a risk. If they're critical of the government, their funding may stop. Now, I understand, you know, organisations like SFC and Audit Scotland, their funding is safe. So on hearing that, what can we do to change that? Because that is an issue.
So I'm concerned to hear that, and maybe we've got a work to do to reassure that that's not the case. What I would say to organisations like SCVO or any others is look at the evidence that where organisations are funded by the Scottish Government, there are many examples of them being critical of policy decisions, of legislative options. There's no shortage of that, and I would have thought that might have given some confidence to organisations that actually if they disagree with the Scottish Government, there should be no question about looking at their funding arrangements in terms of whether they articulate that or not. So maybe we've got a job of work to make that more explicit. But you know, SCVO do, I meet with them regularly. They do a hugely important job in terms of representing third sector interests. And I would want them to say if they were concerned, and many, I'm sure, they are very forthcoming at arguing for more investment in third sector organisations, certainly in the meetings I have with them.
Yeah, and I don't know if it's maybe a fear of funding being removed or a fear that if they apply for extra funding, then that will be taken into consideration. Well, I think that's something that does need to be addressed.
Well, yeah, and if that's the case, we've got some work to do because that should not be the case.
Yeah. Want to move on to lines of communication between ministers and civil servants. I think it was Ms Fraser, I think you mentioned, is there a clear instructions of how a minister and civil servants should be communicating?
Yes, it is very clearly set out both in the ministerial code and indeed the civil service code. So we expect to work together professionally and respecting, offering dignity and respect in the workplace, yeah. And that's very clear. This is an area, I think, where we've made much clearer our expectations on both sides. So obviously a new procedure in terms of if civil servants feel the need to raise a complaint about the behaviours of a minister, but also equally a new grievance procedure within the Scottish Government as well, just making it really clear where colleagues can go if they've got any concerns, for example, about senior colleagues and the way that we behave, or any other concerns that they've got. So just making that as clear and transparent, and as I say, creating that safe environment where people know and understand that it's safe to challenge.
Because the reason I ask is, I think there was one witness that explained that the more transparency you have, the greater risk of decisions being driven away to it. I think it was government by WhatsApp, was the term used. So is that something that's recognised by the Scottish Government? And can we get assurance that that is not happening, that we don't have ministers and civil servants communicating by WhatsApps just to avoid any FOIs or anything else?
I mean, that's certainly not my experience and not the practice that that is in place that I see at all. And you know, I think you've heard some of the detail around why it's important and the improvements that have been made around recording particular decisions and how you know the decision has been reached, and the recording of that is very important. So I mean, hopefully what you've heard here today gives you some reassurance around that.
So just, is there WhatsApp messages between top, you know, civil servants and ministers? Does that happen? Or
I have with my private office a WhatsApp on call group. So that if I put someone in the system at 8 o'clock at night, somebody in my private office picks it up quickly and responds to it. It's a convenient tool around, you know, can I get first thing in the morning? Can I get blah 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 blah? Rather than having to go on and send an email that may or may not be picked up. But that's not about avoiding scrutiny. It's just about quick communication to a range of people, one of whom will pick it up. So that's the example.
And last question I had was around, you mentioned prevention right at the start, and that's something that we've been talking about as a committee for quite a while. And we've often heard it mentioned, but we often hear that it's quite difficult to find the funding for prevention because all the money's gone into the immediate effects. So how are you going to change that?
So this goes back really to the Christie Commission, doesn't it, of, you know, the early intervention, prevention is always better than going back and trying to fix issues that appear further down the track. And of course, we all agree with that. But as you've pointed out yourself in your opening comments about it, it's quite a difficult thing to achieve because... So if you look at the health service, for example, and drawing on my time as health secretary, that clearly in order to reduce pressure on acute care, you need to try and avoid people going into hospital by improving people's health through public health measures, through trying to create a healthier population. But you still need to have that funding for the acute sector. So you have to try and do both. So some of the work that we're undertaking at the moment in terms of so the child poverty plan is a good example of trying to understand the drivers of child poverty and to really get underneath that around the ways of addressing it. So, you know, the upfront Scottish Child Payment, money in people's pockets helps alleviate problems in the here and now, but some of the work around parental employment and improving the life chances of children from an early age, so good quality early years, education, childcare, begin to move it further upstream, which can then reduce, Perm Set was just telling me earlier on about some of the statistics around reduced teenage pregnancy, better attainment. These are the results that you would expect to see later in life from good early years intervention. So do we need to get better at it? Yes, we do. And Christie still has a lot within the Christie report for us to draw upon. And some of the work that we're undertaking at the moment is really trying to hone in on what makes a difference in terms of some of that work.
Is there a specific that you want?
No. It was really just to make sure that the government were focused on prevention, because I don't really see it, to be honest.
Thank you. Thank you to the Deputy First Minister and Permanent Secretary and other officials for coming today. This was our last evidence session in a further inquiry into effective Scottish Government decision-making, and we'll consider our next steps in our inquiry at our meeting next Tuesday. So we'll now take a short break before our next item on the agenda, which is an evidence session with the Permanent Secretary. So if we can, by 15:15, please. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session with John Paul Marks, Permanent Secretary to the Scottish Government, on issues relating to public administration and government. Mr Marks is joined by Leslie Fraser, Director General Corporate, Louise MacDonald, Director General Communities, and Jackie McAllister, Chief Financial Officer of the Scottish Government. So I welcome you all to the meeting today. Thanks for taking the time to come and see us. And I would invite Mr Marks to make a short opening statement.
Thanks, Convener. I thought I'd start with three areas of focus. So the first being our policy advice, particularly the revised policy prospectus, which we have recently published for a new First Minister and a new Cabinet. Secondly, just briefly touch on financial control, given inflation and the fiscal position. And thirdly, touch on leadership of the civil service and how we're trying to build new capabilities for the long term. So first of all, you know, through February and March, new First Minister, new Deputy First Minister, new Cabinet, and a new policy prospectus. Credit the team a lot of hard work to get that published and manage what was a significant reshuffle in government. As we heard a bit more this morning, three missions that respond to the context we're in, but also set out concrete deliverables for each Cabinet Secretary to make progress to the national performance framework, so around equality, to tackle poverty, opportunity to transform our economy and realise net zero, and around community, to recover from this pandemic and secure sustainable public services. In terms of key drivers in the last 12, 18 months since I've taken up post, of course, tragic events in Ukraine and then what that did to inflation and the cost of living crisis that followed. And as I say, that compounding the impact and the risks that the pandemic had created. We went through last year, ministers quite rightly prioritising fair and affordable pay awards to manage down the risk of industrial action, and as we heard this morning, also delivering a warm Scots welcome to a super sponsor programme. Just a few things to call out, which were top of the list. Balancing the budget, of course, but also protecting the things that make the biggest difference to our top priority outcomes. Example being the Scottish Child Payment expansion of its eligibility, enabling child poverty in Scotland to be lower than the UK average, a revised budget tax package, an emergency budget review to balance the budget, and then also establishing new capabilities within our workforce to respond to new challenges. Ukraine, social care improvement, a new ScotWind directorate to reap the benefits from renewables as examples. A lot of focus on partnership and system leadership. So if I take justice, where we've seen a good reduction in our courts backlog, keeping crime low, the prison population 8% lower than pre-pandemic levels, with more criminal justice reform before Parliament now as well. We're in the process, hopefully, of finalising a new deal with local government and also with business as we try and establish the ecosystem for improving start-up and scale-ups in Scotland's economy with tech scalers, code-based, CivTech, and pushing on with our national strategy for economic transformation. I would also just say that collaborative approach shone out for me in relation to Operation Unicorn, where the country came together and provided a fitting tribute to Her Majesty the late Queen. Just as Principal Accountable Officer, key points I would make is the balancing of the budget, 21-22 consolidated accounts, and then again in 22-23, the committee will see the provisional outturn shortly. And the need to effect in-year adjustments of over £1 billion to achieve that in 22-23. We've been focusing on some core capabilities to improve value for money in the Scottish Government around governance, investment scrutiny and financial control, multi-year workforce planning and estates right-sizing, improving public body sponsorship, record-keeping, FOI and correspondence management. We've embedded a private investment framework that is now published and we're applying that every day. We're improving our data and we'll be setting out later in May our medium-term fiscal strategy as well, so that is all transparent. Final point, always it's about building the team. From my perspective, a lot of focus on professions and going deeper on HR, finance, legal, risk, project management and that core competence, but also across Scotland in terms of public service reform and digital transformation. I think our values are genuine. We are embedding a values-based approach to our workplace culture all the time, and I think we've learned good lessons from the harassment reviews. Leslie's led a ton of work on embedding new procedures and controls around propriety and ethics. And if I could just share a couple of statistics. For example, the proportion of disabled people working in the Scottish Government has now doubled from 6.4% in 2013 to just under 15% today. We have very healthy gender balance across the Scottish Government at all levels and all grades, which is encouraging. Our people survey for 22 had record numbers of staff identifying as disabled, female, ethnic minority, LGBT, and our bullying and harassment levels remain at historic lows. We're always vigilant to this culture and improving it, but we're also proud of the diverse and inclusive culture that we are leading. Finally, for me, building my own senior team, Louise, this is her first committee appearance, so I know all will be kind, but Louise has joined us, actually been with us now for over a year from the voluntary and private sector. My new DG Economy has recently come in again from the private sector, and another DG leading our work on net zero who has significant deep major project expertise. So although we talked about churn this morning, we want to manage against that risk. We also want to bring in fresh talent, diversify the capabilities at the top and throughout the organisation, and make sure it reflects the country we serve. We're working hard on our relationships with the UK government, good dialogue every week with civil servants in the UK, and we keep working hard on that as well. Lots of strengths to build on, and important work ahead. Look forward to your questions. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. I'll start maybe with the Lord Maud's review into governance and accountability that the UK government established. That's to recommend ways to make government more efficient, in their view, looking at efficiency and effectiveness of the UK civil service. Can I ask how you would input into that review, given that you'll be charged in part with delivering its outcomes in Scotland?
So there's a number of touch points that we have on a regular basis. So I attend Simon Case's leadership team meeting every Wednesday morning. Leslie is a member of the Chief Operating Officers group for across the UK Civil Service. So those would be two touch points where we will regularly talk about efficiency, governance, transparency. And in fact, was it only last month, there was a Four Nations team meeting to discuss our learning and experience on propriety and ethics, given the experience that colleagues in Whitehall are also stepping through and applying best practice to their own procedures too. So we're sharing all the time. I'm also a member of the Civil Service Board, and that is the most senior leadership group which the Chief Executive of the Civil Service chairs, which is all about workforce, estate, digital transformation, everything about trying to ensure we're building and developing a world-class civil service that can deliver the best outcomes and advice for ministers.
Okay. And the resource spending review, which the previous finance secretary indicated that she wanted to see a return to pre-COVID levels of the size of the public sector headcount and the size of the civil service as well. Could you tell us the status of that work and those policy commitments to reduce headcount?
So in terms of workforce control for the civil service, we established those last year after the resource spending review, both for the first year, but we've also started to try and set that out multi-year in terms of plans by DG portfolio area and directorate, and so that we can try and understand what the trajectory looks like and the choices that can be made. If I take the first year on an overall basis, we still wait for the final reconciliation of the data, we've seen quite a significant reduction in our contracted resourcing, and we've managed our permanent resourcing to a small increase, so the net effect is that we're marginally smaller after the first year. But we need the final data to flow through on that, and then we need to keep developing workforce plans multi-year as well to the end of the parliament, as you say. I think some things will naturally unwind. So we have, you know, Ukraine super sponsor programme that will at some point come to an end, one hopes. A social security programme that is sizeable that will move towards business as usual as we conclude the parliament. But similarly, as Mr Greer was alluding to earlier, some significant major programmes that we want to gear up around heat and buildings, around renewables, ScotWind, and others as well. So first year, we've made progress with it, but I can't pretend that getting back to pre-pandemic levels doesn't have a level of challenge and stretch about it. So we're going to have to work carefully on that in the
years
ahead. It
doesn't sound like, given the scale of the ambition that Cabinet Secretary Forbes set out, that's you're on course to kind of meet those levels, given what you're saying about additional work that's to be taken on.
I think it's still doable, genuinely. So we, in terms of natural attrition, we'll have around 600 to 700 leavers a year. So it would be feasible to still return to pre-pandemic levels by the end of the parliament. But as I say, I think there's a careful balance that needs to be struck. And obviously we've got a new First Minister, a new Deputy First Minister and a new Cabinet. And what I want us to make sure we do through this year is agree the programme, the budget and the capacity necessary. So it's a kind of aligned, fair challenge to deliver the programme.
And just for the sake of clarity, it remains the policy of the government. That hasn't changed given the new administration that's come in. You're taking the same approach that was set out in the resource spending review, and the First Minister has asked you to do that. Is that correct?
I don't think that has been publicly stated by this new government.
But you are continuing on that basis. There's no change of policy in the one that you're working to, by the sounds of things.
In terms of workforce strategy and workforce management?
Yes.
Then it is deliverable if that's what ministers still want us to achieve by the end of the parliament.
But so they've not given you any clarity as to what that might be?
We've got lots of clarity for the prospectus and for 23-24. We have not yet agreed workforce plans with this new set of ministers for 25-26 yet. And we have choices available still for ministers around that for them to make.
Okay, that's interesting. Moving on to a different issue, the 5th of May, the Secretary of State for Scotland, Alistair Jack, was questioning the appropriateness of UK civil servants working for the new Minister for Independence. You've talked about the new regime, the new ministers. I think the Secretary of State wrote to Simon Case at that point, and essentially it was bumped to you. I said, I understand this is a matter for the Scottish Government Permanent Secretary in the first instance. So your response to those issues, please.
So I've responded to a number of pieces of correspondence regarding this. So it is for the First Minister to appoint his ministerial team, given his priorities, and that ministerial team is then voted on by this Parliament. And then it is for the civil service to serve that ministerial team with impartiality. So we serve the government of the day. That includes with regards constitutional reform, and it has been well understood under devolution for many years that the civil service in the Scottish government serves the Scottish government and their priorities, and we provide policy advice, including the development of prospectus paper series for this government to set out its constitutional objectives. And as we alluded to earlier, that is not just a theoretical debate or a strategic long-term debate. It is a here and now reality, whether that be regarding the use of Section 35 or the interaction with the UK Internal Market Act or the Fiscal Framework Review. So from my perspective, there is very clear, proper and regular grounds for the First Minister to appoint his ministerial team. It is necessary for the civil service to serve that ministerial team with impartiality. And there is a clear set of constitutional priorities here and now, which need advising on and tackling. Because if we're going to deliver this government's programme, whether it be on ScotWind's deposit return scheme and a number of other energy reforms and equality reforms, we need to continue to influence and engage with the UK government with regards to the devolution settlement and the constitution. Final point I just wanted to make is, Kieran Martin is a professor at Oxford University, talks a lot about the history of devolution, and it's a history of change. You know, it is not a history of stagnation. And so, to an extent, it is important that I have a capability in the civil service in Scotland equipped to serve ministers in this government, not just now, but also recognising that things can change in the future. We'll continue to seek a Section 30 order so that any referendum would always be on a lawful grounds as per the last referendum in Scotland, but also recognising UK general election in 2024-25, and clearly the future of the constitution of the UK could change again, and we need to have a capability ready to respond.
Okay, thank you. I want to move on to the issue around the harassment reviews, which you mentioned in your opening statements, an issue that obviously this committee has taken previous interest in. I wonder if we could have an update in terms of the kind of changes that have been made, if we can afford officials that opportunity.
Yeah, thanks, Leslie.
Yeah, very happy to. So as the committee is aware, we have introduced a new complaints procedure should a member of staff have a concern about the behaviour of ministers. That has been updated actually in the course of this year to ensure that we can now report transparently on the number of complaints, for example, that we might receive. And we confirmed our first update in December that we have no complaints currently being considered, and that we will also publish the name and the outcome in the event that there is a complaint. As I mentioned in the previous committee, we've also updated our grievance procedure so that similarly is very up to date and draws on industry-wide best practice in terms of giving our own staff confidence about the way in which complaints would be addressed. This sits within a much wider set of activity underway to really address culture and behaviour and how people feel being civil servants in the organisation, and that takes its roots from our civil service code, but also in the service of Scotland, which is our vision and values for the Scottish Government, and that includes inclusion and integrity and kindness, for example. And that manifests itself in a whole different set of ways. So the new propriety and ethics function, colleagues are regularly made aware that if they have concerns, whether that's a formal concern or just something that is really, they have an anxiety and they feel they're not quite sure what to do with it, they can go and get advice there, and that will be treated confidentially and they'll be well supported through that process. We're also just ensuring that in terms of how we train our own senior civil servants and all of our staff, that colleagues are absolutely aware of what our expectations are of them. People understand what to do if a concern is raised and how they should respond to that. We also are, I think, really going to the point of how we can prevent this as well, these kind of issues arising in the future, actively looking and having structured conversations in areas where we might consider there might be a greater level of risk. So we're looking, for example, actively at our people survey results. If there are cohorts of our staff who are saying they feel less safe or less able to report, we'll have structured conversations in a safe space with them to find out how we can take action and improve that. So we're drawing all of that together, really, and that is forming our ongoing activities.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that work as well. In May of last year, I think it was May of 2022, the then First Minister said that they were unable to release details around an investigation of bullying by a minister of civil servants. But then just a matter of days ago, the current First Minister said that he was happy to check if he could reveal details of that. Now, that's a matter of public record. It was reported about, I think, widely in the press, and you'll be aware of that. I think there was some consternation around that because the minister and former minister in question had made a very critical speech about the government the previous day. And I think there's a worry, I think, more generally, that there may be a threatening behaviour around the use of some of these the information that has previously been refused to be disclosed. So I suppose I'd look for the Permanent Secretary's reaction to that in terms of what is proper and what he believes that the current process is in relation to that case.
Yeah. So, as is routine, the new First Minister will be given the opportunity to set out any changes he wishes to make to the ministerial code, and will provide advice accordingly. As Leslie said, we have already published a revised procedure which regards complaints that are brought forward against ministers, but that is not retrospective. And the understanding for historic cases where there was already a clear understanding of the confidentiality and the procedure that was in place, then the revised procedure does not change that. So we've provided advice to a previous First Minister on this, and we'll do so again for the new First Minister.
And it'll be consistent with the previous advice, given what the First Minister said on the 3rd of May, that he was happy to check. So if he checks, he'll find the same advice.
If he checks, he'll find the same advice.
Okay. Yeah. And has the First Minister requested revision of the ministerial code?
So we were already in the process of updating the ministerial code before Ms Sturgeon's resignation. There were a series of changes, some of which relate to the procedure, which we wanted to make sure were up to date. Some related a little bit with regards ministerial business abroad as well. So those changes have been complete and will be shared with the new First Minister and can be published in due course, subject to any amends that he wishes to make.
So he hasn't requested any specific amendments in these form of areas that may be permit him to reveal issues or to have further disclosure?
Not
that I'm aware of.
Not that you're aware of. No. Okay. Thank you. Keith Brown.
Just on the point that was raised previously in relation to ministerial code and the interference in the Scottish civil service in Scotland by the Secretary of State, I had a letter recently from a guy called Lord Pickles telling me various things that I couldn't do and referring continuously to the ministerial code of conduct and the government's position. I think he was referring to the UK government. I just think he's maybe ignorant of what the situation is here in Scotland, but they're in that confusion. It's surely a matter of concern when it comes to a situation where the Secretary of State for Scotland is trying to instruct or countermand some of the things which the Scottish Government is trying to do. And given that this Parliament, I don't think, would settle for its staff being told what to do by the government or somebody else. Given that there's, I think, no local authority that would accept that its officials should be directed by somebody else, is it not probably just a better idea to have a Scottish civil service?
Well, that's quite a question. There's a lot of complexity in there. So look, I do think that our relationships with UK civil servants is very good. So, for example, if I take colleagues in DEFRA, Tamara Finkelstein, who is the Permanent Secretary there, she and I talk regularly around deposit return schemes, around ScotWind. She and her senior team have come to Scotland to meet with me and my senior team because DEFRA colleagues understand that for them to achieve their net zero targets, Scotland has got to plant a lot of trees, restore a lot of peatland, and deliver a lot of renewables transformation, to name but a few of the things that we discussed when we met. Similarly, if I take colleagues in the Department for Work and Pensions, Peter Schofield, the Permanent Secretary there, came to Glasgow for the day with his senior team to sit down and talk about devolution of Social Security, where we have a joint programme working together to ensure that we safely and securely transfer cases across. So I think we get a lot of benefit from, if I take Social Security, the collaboration that we undertake around use of data, fraud and error management, and building our capability there. Similarly, I think we get a lot of value through the exchange of ideas and capabilities with DEFRA with regard to our mission on net zero. So personally, I find the dialogue at official level productive, and I certainly get a lot of insight from being a member of the Civil Service Board and being able to draw on that network of colleagues and the capabilities that it offers.
I just wonder, though, and I completely understand the point you've made and the value of those good relationships which happen, but if it's the case that is very distinct from the experience of ministerial collaboration, such that, for example, if we have various cul-de-sacs placed in the way of this Parliament in relation to Section 30, for example, where, you know, the Parliament's voted for a referendum and it's just ignored out of hand, or the application of the Section 35, or even compare now with, say, 10 years ago when you had the respect agenda, which did lead to, I think, an improvement in relations between different governments and ministers within governments. Nowadays, I know that I've arranged meetings with the UK government and they've refused to give you entry to the MOD to hold a meeting, or just refuse continuously to answer correspondence. If the relationship between the civil servants is generally productive, and yet the relationship between the administrations, that would tend to, we did not argue for a civil service which, to go back to a previous point that was made in the last discussion, where people can accuse organisations of policy capture where they're funded by the Scottish Government. Although, interestingly, this Parliament's funded by the Scottish Government. Nobody argues it's been subject to policy capture. But wouldn't the perception be very important, as much as anything else, to say, as with councils, as with the Parliament, the civil servants that serve the Scottish Government and the public are independent, and that's who they answer to?
Well, I think that was the point I was trying to make with regards to my first answer and constitutional reforms. So I am the Permanent Secretary of the Civil Service in the Scottish Government, answerable to the First Minister, the Cabinet of the Scottish Government and this Parliament. I'm not answerable to the Cabinet in Westminster or Parliament in Westminster in that way, in the way that a permanent secretary working in a Whitehall department is. So I think my first responsibility is to make sure I'm serving this First Minister and his cabinet well with regards to delivering that strategic policy advice and building the team with the capability to do it, and then discharging the duties with regards to being principal accountable officer in the right way, public money, Scottish Public Finance Manual, Scottish Public Finance Act, and delivering optimal outcomes in Scotland. And then finally, leading the civil service in Scotland in a way that is right for this country. And, you know, we're doing our best with that all the time. I don't feel that either UK government ministers or civil servants in Whitehall are telling me what to do with regards to that at any stage. And I think the collaboration and the partnership adds significant benefit that we are able to draw on to be at our best. But, Mr. Brown, I recognise the political context that you're referencing and the level of contention, and it clearly is more acute and more complex today than it was 2, 3, 5 years ago. And there's risks to that in terms of the UK's constitution long term. And as I say, we'll see what the future brings with regards how that might settle down.
Just finally to say that nothing is to do with you personally, of course, the Permanent Secretary. Although I do note that the Permanent Secretary here in Scotland is appointed jointly by the Principal Advisor to the UK Government, the Cabinet Secretary, and the First Minister. And I think it is just a question of perception. And it probably is less of a question when relationships are productive and constructive, but probably, as you say, given the constitutional situation and the standoff, it probably comes more into view for people. But I'm fine with that.
Mason.
Right, thanks very much, convener. When we were reading the papers for today, there was a number of terms that I wasn't familiar with, so I was hoping you could maybe explain some of them to us. So there's the Civil Service Commission, there's the Civil Service Board, and there's a Civil Service Shadow Board. Are you able to kind of explain what they all do?
Civil Service Commission, Civil Service Board, Civil Service Shadow Board.
I'm sure there's more.
Okay.
But obviously we're time constrained.
Yeah. So Civil Service Commission in terms of civil service appointments. So we have a Civil Service Commissioner in Scotland. So I'm looking at Leslie, keep nodding until I get this wrong. Civil Service Commissioner in Scotland who's Neil Gray. So, Paul Gray. Neil Gray is the Minister for the Economy. Paul Gray. So he will sit on panels, for example, for appointments of Director General and as part of the Civil Service Commission. Civil Service Board is a UK entity which leads the civil service overall, of which I'm a member and the Chief Executive of the Civil Service chairs, and I think it has a shadow board, and occasionally members of that shadow board attend the Civil Service Board.
Could pursue that, but I'll not. I'll get out of my depth, I think, quite quickly. Okay. Some of this is kind of touching on the decision making, which we were making earlier. So forgive me if that's overlapping a bit. But one of the issues that came up was about build teams within the civil service, and they are generally kept together, as I understand it, through the progress of a bill, but may then be disbanded after that, which can impact on the actual putting into practice of the new policies or the new legislation and things. Can you just explain how that works around that area?
Yeah, and I'll bring Leslie in, if I may, as well, because this is all part of building this deep professional capability in the organisation. Ultimately, once the bill concludes, you know, the team that are providing briefing on amendments, committee stage, impact assessments and the like may find that the work has concluded and we don't want them to not have anything to do. So absolutely, it's right that they are then given the next opportunity that they want to take on. But your point of the kind of end-to-end implementation of change, clearly there's a lot of advantage having people who understand the detail of the legislation going through into the major change programme or even into the delivery of that change over time. So if I think about Social Security as an example, there's some of the senior leaders who are in there have tracked right through from legislation and development of devolution of Social Security through the pathfinding, the setting up of the agency, and then the delivery. And that continuity of capability clearly has a lot of advantages as well. But Leslie, anything else you want to add?
No, I think it's a really good point, and I think it's important for us to strike the right balance. And very often build teams will be made up of experts, actually, who really thrive on often the cut and thrust of the legislative process together with the subject matter experts. And very often the subject matter experts then will stay as part of the implementation. So we recognise the value of building up that expertise in legislation and understanding how to work with stakeholders and this Parliament in terms of that process, but also you know, the subject matter expertise, that knowledge, that deep embedded understanding of a policy area and the impact on people and then taking that through is absolutely vital as well. So building that well, I think, is when the system works at its best.
I don't know if that's related to the suggestion that, as I understand it, the HR system is now going to be that all civil servants will be categorised into professions.
Yes.
Is that kind of connected there somehow?
It is. We are part of our people strategy. The development of a workforce plan is introducing a new system which will give us much augmented capabilities. We'll give everybody job families, first of all. So that's understanding if you're a policy expert or a legislative expert or a lawyer and so on. And then we do have 21 different professional groupings within the civil service in Scotland already. And some of those are really quite mature. I think about the data and digital profession or the legal profession, for example. Others, the change management profession is a growing area for us in Scottish Government. And the way we're seeking to augment professions is really to take that holistic look across the way that we manage professions, right the way across the organisation and indeed with a number of our public bodies as well, where a great deal of professional expertise sits. So the new system will help us with that, but also then sharing expertise in terms of that career development and how we look after people and offer them really attractive career pathways through Scottish Government and public service in Scotland, I think is an area that we see offering really rich potential for the future.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I was a little unclear of what we can cover today. Can we cover consolidated accounts? Is that the is that something I can raise?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Officer is ready.
Well, I haven't said anything so far. So my first question would just be quite general. Why are some bodies included in the consolidated accounts and other bodies are not included?
So that is determined by the classification of the body and the accounting boundaries. So if it's a ministerial body, for example, it will be within the consolidated accounts, but each will have its own classification, and that will determine whether it sits within or out with the consolidated accounting boundary.
Okay, and is that fixed like forever, or is that something that changes over time?
So it's based on their classification of the public bodies. That can be reviewed at any time by the ONS, and they do routinely review them, but there would need to be a trigger for a change of classification.
Right, so that's the ONS that decide that, so it's very consistent throughout
absolutely.
The UK or whatever.
Yes, absolutely.
Right, okay, that makes sense. I mean, I think some people had expected to see in the consolidated accounts what the reserve balance was, that we've got the limit of 700 million, but I don't think that's a figure that actually appears. Is that correct?
Shall I take this? So yes and no. The Scotland Reserve is linked to our Treasury budget, our HMT budget, which is driven by the fiscal framework. And you're absolutely right, we have a limit of 700 million. It's not the same thing as the consolidated accounts. The consolidated accounts, as you pointed out, they are our statutory accounts for the bodies within the consolidated accounting boundary, and we report in the accounts against the budgets that's set by the Scottish Parliament in the spring in the parliamentary budget, and then adjusted at the spring budget revision. So they're not exactly the same things. But what we do have in the front of the accounts, in pages 9 to 11 of the accounts, is an explanation of why they're different. And what we do have in the accounts as well is the provisional outturn. So again, you'll see in pages 9 to 11 that we have, for 21-22, we have the provisional outturn of 650 million against the headroom of 700 million. And in April of this year, we wrote to the committee with the final outturn information, which we were only able to do after the final accounts that are linked to the HMT budget. So that goes beyond the consolidated accounts. Were complete, and that was the SPPA pension accounts that we were waiting for to be completed.
Okay, I think this is quite a complex area. I think we maybe need a meeting all of its own, but if I could just try one other thing. I think if I'm reading it correctly, there's resource borrowing of 319 million, but there's also an underspend, and I just wonder why we need to borrow if there's an underspend.
So we set out our borrowing plans in the medium-term financial strategy, and we set them out within our budget, and then we review those as we move through the year. There are different reasons as to why we can borrow, particularly on resource, and those are around reconciliations and reconciliation movements in year. we would, and for 21-22, of course, is what you're talking about, we would have built our borrowing plans on the basis of our funding and our spending plans as we moved through the year. I think, as you will recall, we were still quite well within the pandemic at that point in time. And in 21-22, we got some very late notification from Treasury of some very significant consequentials. So that subsequently changed our carry forward assumptions and our funding for that year.
Okay, I'll leave it at that. Thanks, Kevin.
So on this point, Ross Greer.
Just on that point of the underspend, Jack, I'm interested in whether the government thinks there's an issue in presentation here, because the single biggest chunk of the underspend was variation in the student loan market, not a pot of cash that didn't go unspent. But we regularly have stakeholders engage with us who are frustrated that their priority didn't get the spending that they believe it deserved, and they see reports that £2 billion was not spent. Is there a basic presentational issue with the terminology here when we're talking about the underspend?
I think that's a really good point. We're going to continue to look at this. We're going to continue to look at how we can improve the transparency around this. Hopefully you noted in the final outturn report that we've tried to make that connection between the reserve and the outturn and cash and non-cash a little bit more than we've done in the past. But you're absolutely right. I mean, almost half of the underspend for 21-22 was non-cash. And actually, going back to the point about Treasury budgets, there's about £500 million of adjustments that we would have made to the Scottish budget through the SBR had the HMT supplementary estimate process been concluded. So there were late adjustments because of the timing of that. So we had a significantly larger underspend than we otherwise would in any other year. And as you say, some of that was about valuations, which were index linked. And of course, RPI was a significant movement. I think some of those went from plus 13 to minus 4. So you can imagine what that did to the calculation on those valuations. So we did think it was quite unprecedented. But we will certainly look at how we present that, and we'll look to improve the transparency of it going forward.
Thanks.
Audit Scotland have made a range of observations, criticisms, constructive suggestions around transparency, this set of accounts and others, and the Permanent Secretary, I think, will be well aware of those. I think the committee would appreciate a response to those issues raised, if we can. I think maybe that would help to deal with some of the issues that both Mr Mason and Mr Greer are raising. We do have concern, I think, regarding that ongoing transparency issue. So if you could perhaps set that out to us in a letter from the Permanent Secretary, I think that would be appreciated. Can I move to Douglas Lumsden?
A quick question on the underspends, First Commissioner. Obviously, it's down there as £2 billion, but it's not, as Ross Greer pointed out, there's student loans in there as well that you can't really take out. How much money was handed back to the UK government at the end of the year, if any?
There was no loss of spending power to the Scottish Government. So the final outturn, which again is something that you received in April, showed that we came in just below the £700 million cap for the Scotland Reserve. So there was no loss of spending power.
So I guess that's back to the reporting thing. It maybe looks like there's £2 billion, but when you actually dig a bit deeper, it's not as bad as it seems.
So the consolidated accounts and the budgets that we spend within aren't just about our day-to-day spending. They're about our valuations of our assets, our liabilities, our provisions, and we need budget for all of those movements. And the £2 billion underspend is the variance against all of those budgets. We're always going to have underspends. We're simply not allowed to overspend against any of our budget categories. And a lot of the non-cash budgets can be quite volatile, and as I mentioned earlier, linked to inflation, which is completely out with our control. For those types of budgets, particularly the non-cash, we're always going to make sure that we've got enough budget to avoid any unforeseen movements that would lead us to a breach of the budget and a qualification of our accounts.
Mm-hmm. That's good to hear. I move on now to next thing I was going to ask about, if that's okay, was record keeping. Obviously, we had issues around the A21 and A22 when it was difficult to actually find out who'd approved the spend on those vessels. So, Permanent Secretary, could you maybe explain what's changed around that and whether we can now be comfortable as a committee that the proper processes are in place so it doesn't happen again?
I'm going to bring Leslie in because she can just take you through the detail of the approach, but I think, as I said earlier, those incidents that are in the past are regrettable. We want to make sure that we've learned from them and put the fundamentals right so that they can't happen again. There is obviously a raft of engagement that goes on with the Scottish Government all the time. So we're working very hard to get the consistency right. So I can't provide a cast iron guarantee that it will never trip up in the future, but we are absolutely determined to ensure, of course, that all ministerial decisions are documented for the record. And certainly for something like you're referencing a commercial procurement decision, we've published, as I alluded to last year, our private investment framework, which sets out really clearly the due diligence you'd expect to see from us with regards to those investments or future investments, and that needs to be consistently applied. But Leslie, could you just step us through progress on record keeping?
Yes, and I mean, such a fundamental point for the civil service, we must be able to account for and track decisions that are made and the way in which those decisions are made as well. And that goes to the culture, systems and practice changes that we have made. So I'm leading a new information governance programme that's been running for the last 18 months. I chair a board on a quarterly basis. We're looking at all of the changes across staff training, across our systems, across the procedures that we put in place in order to be able to increase the consistency with which we can see best practice being carried out in the organisation. So that includes training for our colleagues. It includes changes to some of the practices, so the way in which we record decisions coming out of ministerial offices and then tracking those and checking that the decisions have been acted on, for example. We've also changed some of the system storage arrangements as well, so that we're, again, just much more up to date, much easier for us to track and retrieve information in a logical way. And just really underpinning through our In the Service of Scotland work with colleagues that this is fundamental to good civil service craft here in Scotland. It's how we expect people to work. It's not a boring bit of what you do. It's absolutely essential and you must do it well. So it's all of those elements really coming together, but being overseen by a senior group in the organisation on a regular basis.
So the past failures of 801 and 802, was that a failure in the process? Was there no process in place, or was it people not following the process that we're meant to?
Well, if we stand back a moment, I mean, I can't remember the total quantum of documents. It's sort of 200 odd documents that we've published with regards 801 and 802, and there's been two inquiries which have set out recommendations which you have accepted, and we've put in place a whole new programme on information record keeping, set out a whole new approach on private investment, due diligence, the framework that we will apply. And we're building new capabilities as well within the organisation, including using external commercial forensic capabilities where we need to inform advice.
Mr. Lumsden's been quite specific about what happened at the time, and if you have a reason for that not happening, not what's going to happen in the future.
Well, I guess you're asking me to describe what happened in 2015 when I arrived here in 2022, so it was 7 years before I got here. And the honest truth is all I can do is read those inquiry reports, the recommendations and the response and get that right. I'm not really able to provide further insight to what those inquiries have already offered to what occurred 7 years ago.
We've talked today about lessons learned.
Yeah.
I mean, around this,
so I have to
in reflecting backwards, there must be lessons learned about this and why it arose.
Yeah, so I've derived the learning from the inquiries, the recommendations that they've offered, and then the processes and the capabilities that we've put in place to respond. I think you're asking me specifically about why was a particular decision not recorded 7 years ago in regards to the procurement of these vessels, to which I can't offer deal of insight beyond what the inquiries have already
I'm trying to
concluded.
Work out whether there was a process missing, a process not followed, or whether there was just a, I think we've heard culture mentioned a good few times today, whether there was just a culture in the organisation that didn't give two hoots about the process that was meant to be followed.
I don't know what more to say, really. I joined the organisation in 2022. You're asking me about events from 7 years preceding that, to which there's been two inquiries, a lot of deep learning done, and a lot of change being put in place. I can't provide a very accurate evidence-based description of what went on in 2015 with the procurement of 801 and 802. I can understand why you might be keen to get me drawn in on offering an opinion on it, but my opinion is derived from the recommendations from the inquiries. I don't have any other insight to it.
Sorry, Mr. Lumsden, can I ask a second rounder then? So the meeting in May 2017 that took place between Nicola Sturgeon and Jim McCall, which I mentioned earlier on, so there was no civil servant present at that meeting. It was a special advisor that attended. We were talking about a very significant issue, public expenditure. I suppose, as an example of what's there, is that a practice? Would that have been an allowed practice at the time, Ms. Fraser? Or was that a decision that was taken by Minister?
I don't think I've got anything further that I can add in relation to that specific meeting or that specific point. I'm sorry, I can't help the convener.
Okay, I don't think we're getting any further on this.
No, I'll change the subject then, convener. We'd heard before that there was three harassment reviews that were taking place in session five. I think we've heard earlier that the First Minister was asking whether one of them could be looked at again. What were the other two? Was it just that one in particular? Or who did he ask, I guess, is probably the first question to ask.
I think the First Minister was specifically asking for advice about whether the legal considerations around complaints made against former ministers could be revisited. So that's advice that we've been able to provide to the First Minister.
All three harassment ones, or just one in particular? That's really my question.
The three harassment reports, which I think which this committee has been monitoring the results of, were the harassment committee's own report of the Parliament, also a report undertaken by Laura Dunlop on behalf of the then Permanent Secretary Leslie Evans, and also the report by James Hamilton into Ms Sturgeon's self-referral under the Ministerial Code. Those were, I think, the three reports which all produced recommendations, which we have reported with the former Deputy First Minister to this committee on over the course of the last 18 months.
Okay, so when the First Minister said he was happy to check if he could legally reveal findings of a previous investigation, was it just on one of those investigations or was it all three? And who did he ask?
That was a different matter relating to a complaint against a former minister, a specific matter, so not directly relating to those three reports, as I understand it.
Okay. Sorry, who did he ask? That was the last question.
He asked civil servants in my area for advice. Yes.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Thanks, Commissioner.
Michelle Thompson.
Just a couple of quick questions, because I know we're coming near to the end. Obviously, as you point out, you've been here since 2022 and you've been able to make a pretty fair assessment of what you noticed at the start. So, given that, what now keeps you awake at night and why?
That's a good question. So, I suppose, you know, I reflected it in my opening remarks, the context for the last year has been really tough for the country, for partners, voluntary sector, business. And when I think about, you know, one minute you're delivering Operation Unicorn and responding to that, the next minute it's is standing up a super sponsor programme, which, credit the team, has been a remarkable effort, but was obviously not what we were planning for when we did the resource spending review. And then just the impact of inflation on fixed budgets for everybody, councils, public bodies, the Scottish Government, has been really, really hard. So that overall impact on our on the well-being of not just our teams, but actually partners and the systems we serve, that certainly gives me a lot of concern. I think a lot of resilience has been drained, first from by the pandemic, then by the cost of living crisis, and everything that is associated with it. Success, I think, for me, you know, if I'm still here at the end of this parliament, before this committee, will be, you know, I hope getting the, I referenced it earlier, those long-term capabilities and resilience right, so that our courts backlog has come down and we are delivering a timely experience in our justice system. We keep crime low, we keep our prison population low, and we're able to make progress on those long-term missions that Scotland can rightly be very proud of, because unlike others, we have statutory targets to tackle child poverty, to accelerate progress to net zero. We understand what we need to do, but double-digit inflation and spending a significant additional amount onto areas that we weren't otherwise planning to clearly makes those challenges harder. Mm-hmm. So I think it's the resilience of the system to deliver reform and our capability to hopefully create a more stable operating environment so that people can focus on the day job and focus on delivering better outcomes. Clearly, there's also a lot of change ahead. You know, UK election will clearly talk to the experience of devolution one way or the other. A lot of my engagement with the UK government, I'm sure, next year will be as part of whatever that transition is and how we respond well to whatever the future brings as well.
So just a couple of quick questions off the back of that. I mean, you talked to the speed of change, which everyone recognises, just accelerating. How well equipped do you think, since you've joined, that the civil service is now to deal with the speed of change, which ain't going to stop anytime soon? We all know that.
Well, everybody keeps stepping up and getting the job done. So, you know, delivering a new policy prospectus in 10 days, you know, a version a day for 10 days in what was going to be, you know, a recess period was a remarkable effort. The way in which the team have handled the reshuffle has been exceptional. I've been through a lot of reshuffles in my life. You know, the end of the new Labour government, Conservative Liberal Democrat coalition down south. But what we went through in terms of First Minister, Deputy First Minister, leaving at the same time, and Nicola Sturgeon and John Swinney, and all that experience was a significant change. The team stepped up and did an incredible job. But look, part of my responsibility is to keep bringing new capabilities in, refreshing the team, building those new capabilities on things like ScotWind and hydrogen and heat and buildings and deposit return schemes, so that we've got the programme capabilities to execute reform. But we are doing it in a fiscal environment that is very, very tight. And so every pound really matters. And it's contested because, you know, everybody wants to do more quite reasonably. So prioritisation then becomes really essential too. So now I have good confidence in the capability of the civil service here. I think the values are excellent. I think there's some deep capabilities. But I think we've got to look after well-being. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just that my last question on that, you mentioned earlier, and I did read in the stats that over 55% of your employees are female, which is great. And you yourself said very health gender balance at all levels. Do you have the, or could you supply the committee, the breakdown at all levels? And I'm particularly interested in the most senior levels.
Yeah.
And just last wee point is a well-being economy, which is now, of course, a priority of the Scottish Government, has a so-called gendered lens at its focus. So I'm aware of time. It may be that you want to give us some more flavour of how you are able to apply that, because obviously it's so much more than just percentage.
Absolutely.
Of gender split. You start to look at procurement and so on, but you might, it depends on time, convener.
Topic, but certainly if we can have the information in writing.
Yeah, and some flavour of that.
Then. Thank you. If we can bring in Liz Smith.
Yeah, can I take you back, Permanent Secretary, to the start of your short statement this morning where you said that the third aspect was leadership of the civil servants. It was put to us by former members of the civil service that one of the problems about the current civil service is that there are too few people who have the ability to know about commercial expertise. Do you agree with that?
All feedback matters. So if that was the view of a colleague or former colleague, then we need to reflect on that. We have a fabulous director of our commercial team, works for Leslie, and we're doing a lot of work on building that profession and a commercial value for money programme. So it's one of those core capabilities that we're building. And so hopefully it will respond to that experience from that individual, so that ultimately all teams can access commercial experts when they need them, because they don't always need to make a procurement or issue a grant or whatever. But that's a shared capability, shared service in our corporate team that we're developing. But there's anything more you want to add?
Yeah, no, I think that covers it very well. I mean, it's a small team, actually, but they are very good at building that capability and capacity and offering that, not just within Scottish Government, but with across public bodies as well. So the frameworks and support that they provide already generate savings of in excess of 100 million per annum. And we're looking always at different ways in which we can extend and expand that. I'm sure we'd be happy to...
It was put to us in the context that when it came to various procurement issues, whether that was BIFAB or Prestwick Airport or various other things, that it would have helped if there had been more civil servants who had experience of the necessary decision-making.
So one of the things we've changed, responding to the learning of the past, is pull together a strategic assets unit who manage all of those strategic capabilities. So if there was an interest in undertaking such a future investment, then we would apply what is now a published framework for undertaking that due diligence, that procurement, and that investment. So we've absolutely sought to establish that capability, something Louise worked with me on last year and has been taking forward this year further. So and part of that is using external advisors where we want to get additional due diligence or capability in-sourced to undertake a value for money assessment or help develop a business case. So I think that is work in progress and improving, but obviously always want to remain vigilant to that.
Okay, so you don't disagree that there has been an issue there?
Well, I think one of the lessons from the Ferguson's experience is the need to establish expert commercial private asset management capabilities in the Scottish Government that draws on independent advisers. That's what we've now done, and I think that would stand us in good stead for the future.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you to you all for your evidence today, for answering all of our questions. And that concludes the public part of today's meeting. Next item on our agenda will be discussed in private as consideration of our work programme. So we now move into private session. Thank you.
Thank you.